Hi, I'm Alex from Tailscale. I want to talk to you today about the Apple TV. And we made a video about this late last year and told you about how to use your Apple TV as an exit node, how you could use it with Mulvad. There'll be a link to that video just up here. But today I wanted to just highlight something that we asked you about in that video, subnet routers. I'm delighted to say that as of Tailscale 1.56, we've actually added subnet routing functionality to the Apple TV. Now, we do recommend installing Tailscale directly on as many clients as possible. That's because each connection is end-to-end encrypted, and when you move those devices between different sites, you don't need to do any reconfiguration. They'll automatically figure out with the NAT punching that Tailscale does how to reconnect to one another. However, in some situations, we do understand that it's not possible to install Tailscale on every single client device, a printer or a coffee pot or a random Wi-Fi access point that one of your relatives just brought home from the store and says, hey, can you configure this for me remotely? It happens, right? And so in this situation, you probably want something called a subnet router. So let's use the Apple TV as an example here. We're going to turn it into a subnet router using the new functionality that we just added and use this as a low power, always on device, because even when the Apple TV is asleep, it's using a couple of watts. It's still usable as an exit node and a subnet router, which makes it perfect to just stick under the TV and just forget about it. It's not using really hardly any power at all. Time for a little bit of networking theory. Hopefully by this point, you're all familiar with the fact that when a device connects to Wi-Fi or you plug in an Ethernet cable, it gets an IP address. Well, it does that from a DHCP server, which typically lives on a router. So in a lot of residential settings, this is the box that your cable internet provider gives you or your ISP or whatever. Now, in a residential scenario, we're probably all used to seeing the 192.168 IP address space. This is a reserved block of IP addresses. So if you start trying to type 192.168.whatever to try and get to Google or something, it's not going to work. That's because these addresses don't route across the public internet. They stay local. There are a couple of other ranges too. The 10.whatever range, I think, is also another one. There are different RFCs that govern which IP address ranges are reserved. Now, interestingly enough, actually, the Tailscale 100.IP address space is actually a carrier-grade NAT reserved IP address block as well. So if you want to read more about that, I'll put a link to the Tailscale documentation about our IP address space down below. So when we look at the anatomy of an IP address, we've got four different octets, and then we have a subnet mask. So in our case here, we have 192.168.16. whatever the client IP address, the final octet is. The subnet mask, you've probably seen this written as 255.255.255.0. We have a shorthand in networking circles called CIDR notation, C-I-D-R. And in this case, we can shorthand notate that horrible 255 dot long name to just a slash 24. What that means is that there are 254 IP addresses available within that subnet. You might see other shorthand notations of like a slash 16 or something like that, where there are 65,536, 35, I always forget, IP addresses available. Now, obviously, that's not going to be suitable for most residential deployments, but it's just useful to know when you're seeing what these different, you know, slash notations might be used for. And so in my case here, what I want to do is allow access to all of those 255 devices on the slash 24 subnet, which belongs to the 192.168.16 subnet. In my case, I've got an IPMI interface on my server that can't run Tailscale. That's because it's an HTML5 web console built in as an embedded chip onto my server's motherboard that lets me remote control the server as if I'm physically sat at a keyboard and monitor in the remote network. IPMI is super cool, by the way. If you've never tried it out, just type it into YouTube and have a look. You're in for a treat. But in our case, I want to be able to access the IPMI interface even if I'm not physically in that remote network. So by using a subnet router, I can rewrite the traffic. So when I make a request for that subnet, Our Tailscale infrastructure has the knowledge that you have allowed that subnet router to forward packets for that specific destination subnet. So it does a match and it goes, hey, you probably want to route the traffic through this particular subnet router. And then the subnet router rewrites the packets as if they originated from that specific device itself. What's particularly interesting for me, at least, is that that IPMI device or the printer or whatever other device is in the subnet that's not on your tailnet has absolutely no idea that Tailscale was involved in the transaction whatsoever. So far as that remote client is concerned, the traffic originated from the subnet router itself, whether that's your Apple TV, a Linux box, or your firewall. Now, if you're a little bit paranoid about allowing every device on your tailnet access through a subnet router to a remote network, you can lock this down in ACLs. I'll put a link to the ACL documentation down below. That's a topic for an entirely separate video. But what remains as a topic for this video is talking you through the Apple TV interface. So here we are at the Apple TV. I'm going to load up the network page just here, and you can see I'm connected to my Wi-Fi. I've got an IP address. This again is a local IP address of 10.42.10.105. And if I open up the Tailscale VPN section, I want to just dig into some of the connection details that are here. You can see that the connect on demand is true. You can see all the different search domains that I have as split DNS within my Tailscale tailnet. And then also underneath, we've got an option to actually open up the Tailscale app. So let's go ahead and do that. And you can see we've added a new section here. You've seen the exit node thing before because I showed you that in the previous video. But if we go down to here, subnet router. Oh yes, here it is, folks. So let's have a quick look at advertising a new route on here. So by default, you know, the route that it's going to advertise is 192.168.1.0/24. Go ahead and customize that to your needs. So once you've got the advertised routes configured correctly on the Apple TV side of things, go ahead and jump over to tailscale.com, click into your admin console up in the top right-hand corner, find the Apple TV in question. In my situation, this is Apple TV Travel. This is the one I take with me when I take a business trip or something. And then click on the three-dot menu on the right over here, click on Edit Route Settings, check the box, click Save, and we're done. This Apple TV is now configured as a subnet router for your tailnet. Now, the whole reason that subnet routing came to the Apple TV was because you asked for it. In the comment section of our last video, loads of you let us know that you wanted to see subnet routing brought to the Apple TV. That's why the feature was created. So well done to everybody that commented down below. Now, if there's a feature that we're not yet working on you'd love to see us do, let us know in the comments down below. We read every single one. Now, until the next video, you have to go forth and spread Tailscale subnet routers and exit nodes on low power devices wherever you go. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. Until next time, I've been Alex from Tailscale.